Morning, everyone. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm Dr. Peter MacDonald, orthopedic surgeon and chair of the steering committee for the task force, the Diagnostic and Surgical Recovery Task Force. Before we get our program underway, we'd like to acknowledge that that Manitoba is on the treaty territories and ancestral lands of the Anishinaabeg, the Anishinaabeg, the Dakota Oyete, the Denisulan, and the Nihanewak peoples. We acknowledge that Manitoba is located on the homeland of the Red River Métis. We also acknowledge that northern Manitoba includes lands that were the ancestral lands of the Inuit. We respect the spirit and intent of the treaties and treaty making and remain committed to working in partnership with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people and the spirit of truth, reconciliation, and collaboration. Again, thank you all for attending this update on the Diagnostic and Surgical Recovery Task Force. Just over a year ago, the task force launched essential measures to tackle the critical situation brought on by the pandemic and its various waves, which put a halt to many necessary diagnostic and surgical procedures. I remember saying that some of the problems faced by our system are complex, and they continue to be complex, and they won't be solved in the short run. I also referred to the task force mandate, where I mentioned that we will be able to help Manitoba patients who need help today by reducing and eliminating health system backlogs caused by the pandemic. We said we would need to do that in any way possible, as quickly as possible, to ensure that patients got the care that they need. I'm pleased to stand here today and echo the minister's progress update that Manitobans are getting that care, and we're working on advancing that as we speak. To give a quick overview of the progress to date, let's first look where we are with the diagnostic backlog reduction. The diagnostic backlog reduction has been reduced by about 30%, 31%, a significant reduction. The surgical backlog reduction has also gone down in the 30% range. Procedures, even like orthospine and cardiac surgery, are down, and the surgical backlog overall reduction has been quite dramatic. There are significant reductions in the total backlog. 26,464 patients have been treated, 10 backlogs have been eliminated, and 5 backlogs significantly reduced. I note that when the Diagnostic and Surgical Recovery Task Force was struck, the purpose was to address increased wait lists as a result of the pandemic. So just to be clear, when we say backlogs have been eliminated, there may still be a wait list in that area, but it's been eliminated in that it's down to pre-COVID levels. I'm happy to state that across multiple service areas, 10 pandemic backlogs have been completely eliminated, 5 have been significantly reduced. So the eliminated are the following: 100% eliminated, and that's down to pre-COVID levels. Cataracts, cath lab, pacemaker, ultrasound, and CT scan. You can see on the slide the number of backlogs that we start with, number of patients in the backlog to start with, and now it's down to 0. Pandemic backlogs have also been eliminated in the following: pediatric neurodevelopment assessments, urology, although we continue to have urology wait list or wait issues, but we're down to pre-COVID levels. Orthopedic other, which means orthopedic surgery other than hip and knee replacement. Oral surgery and dentistry, and echocardiography. Significant backlog reductions have been attained in cardiac surgery, and we started off with the number being 102 and it's down to 47. Bone density from 1385 to 656. Pain management from 386 to 208. Orthospine from 397 to 22, and adult allergy from 123 to 42. So the only signals, this not only signals significant progress, but it's an important indicator that shifts the pandemic backlogs to future focus, which is where we want to be. So next, I want to ask my colleague, Dr. Ed Buchel, provincial head of surgery, who in a moment will speak to what this all means for the future, the system, what the system is doing to build capacity. Before I turn it over to him, I'd like to add some perspective to these numbers and what this has been in terms of achievement. This task force recognizes the outstanding work of the service delivery organizations, and one example of a SDO service delivery organization would be WRHA. The partnership with the task force is important. Provincial clinical planning has to be in tune with the task force. We provide resources so that the SDOs, the service delivery organizations, can expand capacity, meet targets, and reduce and eliminate the pandemic backlogs. They've all been very cooperative, and we've been working very well with them. To that end, the task force is very grateful to healthcare providers across the system and the suppliers who continue to rise to the occasion to provide excellent care to thousands of Manitobans in this extraordinarily challenging time. And we recognize that this means a lot of overtime for nurses and other allied workers. There's a significant number of task force projects on the go, nearing 90 projects. So we're a busy organization. Most of it doesn't make the headlines, but there's a lot going on behind the scenes. The task force is administering a lot of projects in the province. So it's not just about out-of-province surgery. Only a small number of projects are actually dedicated to out-of-province surgery. So most of the work is in-province system building. So I'm going to call on Dr. Buchel, who will speak more specifically to that.
Ed. Thanks, Dr. MacDonald. This is actually a great announcement from my standpoint, because I get to tell you all the good things that are happening. We're not there. We're not finished. We're continuing to work. But, you know, from a big picture standpoint, the picture's looking pretty good now. We're the system, surgery, all the rest of the diagnostic services have been and continue to be very well integrated with the task force. The task force is helping us drive this backlog down to zero and hopefully reduce our wait lists also that existed before the pandemic. So it's important to understand, and I think Dr. MacDonald talked to this a little bit, about the difference between our backlog and our wait lists. But the task force and the system are working at both simultaneously, hopefully, so that we can eliminate both into the future. So what I specifically want to talk is give real data, real information out there about all of surgery, all the types of surgery, and what is specifically being done in our province to improve access to care, timeliness of care, and better care in our province. And this is facilitated by working together with the task force and the system. It's the system that provides the care, and the task force is enabling this. So, building capacity, elimination of our surgical procedure wait lists. We've talked about the backlog. We know what's happening with the backlog. It is being reduced, but so is our wait list. So, many years of planning has gone into this. As soon as COVID started, we started to figure out how we were going to deal with things. And when you're talking about surgery and procedural based care, you're really looking at four, what I refer to as four S's. So we need space, we need staff, nurses, allied healthcare, we need the surgeons and anesthetists to deliver that care, and then we need some degree of data management. We have been told numerous times, where do you get that wait list from? How come we don't know immediately what those wait lists are? We acknowledge that we don't have the best waitlist managements in our surgery system, and this is primarily a foundational thing that we're working towards. So data management systems starts with the task force. They've acquired huge amounts of data as to what our waitlists are, and we're now going to fulfill that mandate and carry it forward so we know what's going on. We also, I'm going to talk quickly about endoscopy and a small degree the pain clinic and the spine clinics that are happening now, because they are really huge in terms of delivery of care to people in pain and needing surgical care. So what's happening? First of all, big picture, broad strokes. Every SDO in our province, Northern, Interlake Eastern, Prairie Mountain, Southern, WRHA and Shared Health, every single one has been improved upon because of the interaction with those SDOs and the task force. It's not just WRHA, it's not just Northern, it's all of us. We're all going up at the same time. Most surgical services have been impacted by the task force in one degree or another. Nursing, allied healthcare, increasing the training positions, new job types being created, recruitment, retention. This task force and HHR task force are all involved in this together. Physician recruitment and physician retention. Even though we're not specifically recruiting through the task force is facilitating us to develop a system that people want to work in, that they're not going to get burned out in. So we retain our nurses and we can recruit the brightest and best surgeons into our province. Back to data management really quickly. What's happening in data management? SWIM, Surgical Waitlist Information Management System. Who's waiting for surgery? Where are they waiting? For how long and for what procedures? This has started several years ago. I like to be able to tell you that we are going to be going live in the city this fall. Implementation and trials of implementation are already happening to make sure that we don't have any hiccups when we start, but this will be starting in fall of this year. E-consult and e-referral. So this is getting things done electronically where a surgeon needs a physician needs to refer to a surgeon, so a consult or referral happens electronically from anywhere in the province. We have done the RFP process for that, and we're now working on the contracts with the vendor to have this hopefully established within the next 1 to 1.5 years. So SDO capacity increases, where are we seeing the increases? I already said it's broad spectrum, and I'll tell you what's happening. So Prairie Mountain is incorporating OR capacity to the tune of 20% increase in Prairie Mountain, specifically at Brandon. This is new OR theaters, or theaters being reused maximally in that area. Southern, increase in the OR capacity at Steinbach and St. Anne. Again, this is facilitated by optimizing resources that we have in that area. Interlake Eastern already online with increased OR and procedural capacity for the surgeries and the endoscopies in that area. WRHA, Concordia, we've talked about this in the past. New operating rooms for orthopedic surgery. That's 1,000 extra hips and knees that are going to be done at that site in that operating room that has been built by a collaboration with the system, the foundation, and the task force. So we are integrated in this. Not only us, but the foundations at the hospitals. Victoria, 14 new slates per month being done. Pan Am, 4 slates per month being done. Misericordia, 5 slates per week being done. So you can see general surgery, urology, ophthalmology, hips and knees, all being targeted. St. Boniface Hospital also being done. New hybrid vascular suite just came online in the last several weeks with new and better treatment for minimally invasive vascular surgery. Shared Health, HSC. So there's huge amounts of stuff going on. An operating room has already been built. There are 6 to 8 more operating rooms coming online in the next 1 to 2 years. The vascular hybrid suite, similar to St. Boniface, will be online within 1 year. Urologic clinic for Manitoba, where we do more scopes, more procedures, treat more people in a timely fashion, is coming online hopefully by March of next year. It's already under construction. What are we seeing in terms of endoscopy? Gastroenterology, so GI, GU, urology, and thoracic have all seen increases. Why is this so important? Because we focused a lot on increasing endoscopy procedures because it treats people, it diagnoses people early, and it treats people earlier so they don't progress in their cancer. We know that is terrible for patients, it is cost ineffective, and it sucks down resources out of the system. So there has been a heavy influence or a heavy focus by the task force and the system to come forward and say, okay, prevention is important. Endoscopy leads to prevention. We need to focus on that. Huge increases in endoscopy. What is happening is you can see that we are pulling things out of operating rooms in our rural areas so that operating rooms can be used for operations, not endoscopy. We have now started research projects and initiation of artificial intelligence on our scopes so we can standardize the care right across the province. And most importantly, centralized intakes so that the care you get and the timeliness of care doesn't depend on geography in our province. So we have centralized intakes in the city, in Southern, and now in Interlake Eastern. That is all starting and soon to be rolled out to the rest of the province so we know who's waiting, why they're waiting, and how long they're waiting for. This is key. It's been put forward and advanced through a combination of the task force and our system. What is our actual increases in endoscopy? If you look at these slates, and I just put up slate numbers here, 5 slates here and 5 slates there, each slate is approximately 10 cases. So we're starting to talk about flin-flon, doing an incremental 50 cases per month in flin-flon. That's super, that doubles their capacity. Selkirk, you can see, Bossier, Steinbeck, Seven Oaks, St. B, Vic, and HSC are all seeing increases in our endoscopy capacity. Quicker care, timely care, cost-effective because it's early diagnosis. We are also doing RFSAs for Manitoba Clinic, Assiniboine Clinic, and Winnipeg Clinic to increase as soon as we can care to those people. So we are looking at every option, system and outside in the clinics that also service our patients currently. Spine surgery, huge focus. What's being done other than sending people to the States? A lot. So spine assessment clinic. This is, you have to realize that 80% of people who come in with a spine problem don't need surgery, but they do need to be seen and referred to an appropriate physiotherapist or other medical intervention or our pain clinic. The spine assessment clinic used to see about 170 patients on average per month. They're now in excess of 500 patients per month. The wait times for seeing somebody in the spine assessment clinic was about 150 days. It's now down averaging around 55 days. So we see huge reductions in wait times for a spine assessment clinic. Maple Surgical Center doing minimally invasive spine cases. 267 cases have been done at the Maple Surgical Center. A new collaborative clinic where we take orthopedic surgeons, neurosurgeons, physiotherapists, and we combine them all together so we have timely patients get timely access to all of those people simultaneously, one visit. Huge improvements. We see expansion by investment in technology at Health Science Center. Because that's the majority of the major surgery for spine is done there, in robotics, laparoscopic surgery, intraoperative imaging. Those have been bought now or are being bought shortly so that we can deliver the best care for our patients and recruit the best surgeons because we have the best equipment. We are hiring new surgeons for Brandon, new surgeons for Winnipeg, and augmenting our surgical base that we have. Similar, thoracic surgery. We have a thoracic surgery clinic that is one of the best thoracic surgery clinics for minimally invasive and early diagnostic procedures in our country. We're expanding that by 40%. So we know lung cancers continue to be a problem. Early diagnosis is how we do this. This clinic is the focus of early diagnosis and minimal invasive surgery so that we can get those people in and out of the hospital as soon as possible. Our volumes are at or above our pre-pandemic levels. Our backlog for thoracic surgery has been eliminated. Again, the majority of thoracic surgery is cancer, so we never let it get out of control. Our wait lists continue to be reduced, even though the numbers of patients being seen at the thoracic surgery clinic continue to increase. We are recruiting new surgeons. Proud to say it's our first thoracic surgeon who is a female, and that's a big deal for surgery. Medicine has now switched to, 50-50 or even more females in medicine. Surgery is still a long ways down the line, but this is a significant portion for us. We've recruited two new thoracic surgeons, and when you think we only have four or five, two is a big deal for thoracic surgery. Ophthalmology, we hear a lot about cataracts. Yes, we have RFSAs for cataracts. Yes, the backlog has been eliminated, but we will eliminate the wait list within 1 to 2 years based on what has been established through the task force and funding the system. So this is huge for ophthalmology, but it's not just about cataracts. It's about supporting Misericordia Hospital to do more cataracts and increase the number of slates so we can deliver retinal surgery, new glaucoma treatments that didn't exist before we started through the task force, so that we can have the best treatment for all ophthalmologic care. We are recruiting more ophthalmologists, and you can see at the bottom, Winnipeg, Brandon, and new pediatric ophthalmologists have been recruited or being recruited in the next year. Orthopedic surgery, again, we talk about hips and knees, Concordia's new operating room, Pan Am to maximize their OR space, and then funding for increased joints. Last year, we said do as much as you can. So who did more? Everyone did more. Brandon did more, Boundary did more, Grace did more, Concordia did more. Everyone did more, so we funded them for that. We've increased the numbers dramatically at Grace and it's continuing to increase. Boundary and at Concordia. Not only are we doing more, but we're doing better, and we're trying to do them better and quicker. So the focus is on outpatient arthroplasty surgery. One of the leaders in that is Boundary Trails. They're at between 50, as high as 70% of their cases are now being done as outpatient surgery. That is huge for our system. It is facilitated by some of the physiotherapists that you've heard about, the funding from our government for physiotherapy, and funding physiotherapy in the actual hospitals where those where that surgery is shifting from inpatient to outpatient surgical care. Recruitment, again, important. How do we recruit? We produce a good system that physicians are wanting to work in. So we are recruiting for arthroplasty and other orthopedics throughout the province. Cardiac surgery, I don't really need to go through this. Dr. MacDonald talked about the cardiac cath lab and the cardiac wait list, but it continues to be at pre-pandemic levels or better than pre-pandemic levels. Urology, huge backlogs of patients. Some of the backlogs have been completely eliminated. Wait lists are still a problem with urology. One, because we don't have enough urologists. Two, because there's a huge demand. So where are we increasing urology? Across the whole province. Selkirk's capacity has increased for both operative and endoscopic or cystoscopic surgery. St. Anne's in Southern has increased. The Assiniboine Clinic has increased, and HSC will be increasing dramatically. We have recruited three new academic urologists to our province in the last year, and recruitment continues for at least three more. General surgery, again, same thing. Steinbeck, Selkirk, WRHA, and now the implementation of something called Vectors. Again, this is for all of our province, a coordinated intake system, kind of a central intake for our acute care patients and our trauma patients that will be implemented throughout our province. Very large impact on triaging patients and getting them to the right place in the right time and supporting all of our rural communities that need to know where to send patients. But it's not just about building capacity. We know we need to train our own. We know we need to retain our own. So all of our residency programs for surgery are fully accredited. All of our residency programs for anesthesia are fully accredited. And that might seem like a strange thing, but it doesn't happen very often. Our PRA programs, which are practice-ready assessments for anesthesia, the government has said, yes, we understand we can't even train enough right now. So we'll bring people in and we'll expedite that process through the PRA program. So the government is understanding our needs for new physicians in surgery and anesthesia and supporting that through an enhancement of the PRA program. The ACA program, Anesthesia Clinical Assistance, for anesthesiologists. For me to deliver surgical care, I need anesthesiologists. If I don't have enough anesthesiologists, or if I want to expand their reach, we give them helpers that allow them to run more rooms with less anesthesiologists. The ACA program was critical to this. It has now been expanded, and that will continue to expand over the years. Again, funded through the government by listening to what the physicians are asking for. OR assistance. We know nurses are burnt out. We know we're asking them to cover weekends and nights and do extra things because of the pandemic and to eliminate our backlog and wait lists. We have developed an OR assistant program that we are training 70 full-time positions. The training has already begun. We anticipate that by September of this year, they will be actually in our operating rooms and procedural rooms. Where will they be? They'll be at Pan Am. They'll be at HSC. They'll be out throughout the entire system to support the nurses in the operating room so we can deliver more care and not burn out our staff. Retaining and recruiting, I speak to this a lot. If we build spaces and we recruit nursing and allied health staff and we implement our data management system, we will continue to do those things while we recruit and retain. Why will I be able to recruit and retain people, surgeons, to stay in this province? Because we're building a better system. We're building it together with the government, with the task force, with the system. We will have better technologies. We will have better remuneration models. And we will have better support for our clinics and our operating rooms. And that will allow us to continue to grow. That's all I have to say. I wanted to give as much information as I possibly could about how the system is growing. As we deal with our backlog, we are simultaneously dealing with our wait lists and building redundancy in our system through our people and our places and our equipment. But we have to do that together. So, anyways, thank you very much. I think we're open for questions. Dr. MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Ed. Take some questions.